Hello and welcome back to the Healthcare Uncomplicated YouTube channel. Before I go ahead, make sure you subscribe to the channel, also share all the previous content there for you. And today gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Anca del Rio. She's the digital public health thought leader, a healthcare 4.0 strategist. She's also an innovation governance expert and global keynote leader, and also a former athlete. I really like that one. Hello, Anca, how are you?
Hi, João. Nice to see you after a short while. I'm very good. I hope everything is good on your side too, and also that the audience is sitting somewhere chill, hidden from the heat wave that is striking this week.
Yeah, we're talking about that before the recording. In Europe, in US, it's very, very hot, isn't it?
Yes, indeed. And I think this is another reason to really believe that the climate change is true, and to see how it's actually coming into course of action with healthcare in general. You see, the conversations are starting to spice up again. And but it's summer. We're dealing with it. We try to do the best we can. We have also our good advices, such as from the WHO and other agencies, how to hydrate, how to stay fit, how to sleep and rest well. So
sure,
all the needed support.
Brilliant. And today we are here to discuss the main barriers to innovation and the future of digital public health. And the first question that I have for you, Anca, is what are the main barriers to innovation in an health system?
Oh, that's a very complex. I mean, the question is very simple. The answer is probably very complex. In my experience, it also varies from system to system. So if you're looking at Europe, you see several discrepancies between the countries. Then if you want to look at the macro level and you want to compare just Europe as a whole with the ambitions that the WHO European office has, as well as the European Commission and the DigiSante, compare those with the US, we look at different dimensions again, comparing, as you know, also with Asia and the advances that are being done there. Again, we're talking a different language. And I would say last but not least, I think it's important to really pinpoint the developing countries. And when we talk about innovation, not to forget anything behind. I think the biggest challenge is actually to align all stakeholders to the common goal, to align them to what really means transformation, so that they can not only join forces in terms of efforts, human resources, financial resources, but also to align purposes. Whereas the state actors can be fully aligned with big tech, to say so, or with the pharma companies, bring all of them at the same table, put the patient in the middle, and have them talk the same and speak the same language. I think that's one of the biggest challenge. And then scaling up one level, it's about aligning the member states, it's about aligning the countries with each other, because right now we are talking about a lot of mobility, right? So you see, just you and me, we come from different countries and we live in different countries, and we are in a different place every month, every year, with different purposes, just traveling the world. So it's very, very important to have access to the same standards, to have the same quality of care, patient safety insurance everywhere we go. And I think that's something that's, as I said, the answer is quite complex to a very simple question.
Thank you, Anca. I mean, you mentioned some really important things there. Certainly the alignment between different interests and different stakeholders is definitely a challenge. Moving on, how can we overcome bottlenecks and ensure fit for purpose in the digital health systems?
I think big bottlenecks, or one of the biggest bottleneck when we deploy health tech, health technologies in general, regardless if it's digital health or med tech solutions, It's actually the point where startups need more access to what really is point of care, to what really is deployment of their technology. I think that's one of the major bottlenecks. On one hand side is the comprehension or the understanding from the stakeholders that sit at the implementation side. So to speak, healthcare providers, pharma companies, wherever is actually the practical point where things can be actually reaching the patient, and giving the opportunity and having the openness to learn about the new developments, to understand the new developments, the innovation and the solutions, and not only to have a conversation with those, but to enable a bridge between what it is applicability of health tech and what is the innovation per se. So what I would really, really like to see in order to open the door to fit for purpose, digitally enabled health systems, it's actually more meaningful adoption of technology in practice. And by practice, I don't mean just healthcare provision, but also, as I said, pharma companies, R&D and research. Basically, what can we take from the level of open innovation or even externalized open innovation and bring it to the point of care? And how can we measure it? How can we really see, does it make a difference? Does it create an impact? Does it bring return on investment? This is something that health systems have not been looking into quite deeply in the past decades. And they started to raise eyebrows only after the pandemic, when the fact that the healthcare expenditure is so high in so many health systems became something undeniable. So I think that there's a lot to be done in order to overcome bottlenecks, but probably what I would really, really like to further support in my different roles and also see as true progress is opening the doors for innovators and entrepreneurs to this endpoint, to the applicability, and having the openness to understand that innovation comes from different and very versatile environments these days.
Oh, thank you. Anca, you mentioned some really important things, not things that we talked about for a while. I mean, the implementation, the adoption, but also it feels like to me that most things are quite new, measuring the impact, measuring how do we well implement. The other day, I interviewed someone about the effectiveness of digital health tools. So all these things are actually new frameworks, new good practices. So as you mentioned, it's quite a lot to consider and to really analyze and learn, right, basically. And moving on, the third and last question that I have for you is, what are things to consider in digital health transformation from a multi-stakeholder perspective?
I would say the alignment. So basically, you mentioned a very important point right now. You said that there are so many frameworks, that change is happening, transformation is happening, and I couldn't agree more. However, I think we're lacking alignment. And I think that would be something that needs more effort and needs more work towards. Apart from bringing all stakeholders together, having industry talk to each other, having reached the point where we have a clear understanding that healthcare is different, health tech is different than fintech, than other sectors that can move fast and break things. We can't do that. We got to the conclusion and we don't ask anymore the question, but why? So now this thing is clear. I think this has been established. But the next point is, how do we align the frameworks? You see, João, we work with so many different measurements. It doesn't matter, the measurements are not there. We have on one hand side, and you know this, the NHS, and they provide a lot of statistics and they gather a lot of data. We have in Switzerland, we have the statistics ministry, which requires this mandatory procedure to the hospitals to not only report financial data and bedside data about their patients, but there's so much more in the background. The first line, I think, is a need for alignment into what is really, really needed, because the ecosystem has changed. The needs of the patients have changed. The way that we actually approach change management in healthcare has come to a different level. And I think that the standards at regional or national level needs to be adapted. And the second step would be probably to align those between the countries, between the regions, between the different health systems, in order to reach the digital health transformation that we aim for.
Brilliant. I really like that. The alignment, certainly very, very important. But also your first point was like, as if we need to narrow down the focus. I really like that. Anca, this is a very interesting conversation. Thank you so much. We come to the end of the interview. We could spend probably 1 hour on each question instead of a 15 minutes interview, but that's a different story because there's so much to talk about, to learn, to explore. But I finish all my episodes with a question. I'm very unrealistic. It's a big question. I want a simplistic answer. And the question is, how can we make healthcare uncomplicated?
Again, simple question, complex answer. Healthcare is not as complicated as it seems. I think it's above all, it's a human right. And when we talk about human rights in general, it's black and white, right? We have laws, we have principles, we follow those, we have authorities. These structures are in place. The question is, do we need all the structures that have been put in place hundreds of years ago and have been built upon? Or maybe should we just break the silos, break the walls, and make it more simple for the patient? So I don't want to answer with another question, but I'm asking this myself as well. In my job, previously working a lot in the hospital setting and with the health systems, currently working a lot with different stakeholders, different actors, lots of startups and entrepreneurs in health tech. I always say the way we can push things forward in healthcare and in health innovation is if we think that we're all patients. It does not matter that you're not a patient today or you're not diagnosed, thank God, to the date when you actually think about it. But even if you're an innovator, even if you're a doctor, at the moment when you actually think about it, that could be me. It's probably the moment when you get things right. And it's the same for decision makers and policy makers, because when we think about the future of healthcare, we have to think about the drivers, the main drivers, and then of the influencers from the ecosystem. So I think that it requires another round of interviews. How can we make healthcare less complicated? I think we just need to break the walls, break some walls, and see how we can build back or how we can build upon better by keeping the patient in the center and keeping our mind as we create everything for the patient and if we were the patient.
Brilliant. Anca, thank you so much. And I really love your answer, because then we kind of, if we think like we all patients, we get the compassion, the empathy, but also the good innovation as it should be. And we close some gaps that we talk around the world. And you go to a lot of conferences, we talk about, oh, this is missing. We don't understand the patient. We can't deliver empathy. Technology is great, but technology doesn't deliver everything that healthcare needs. And we forget that. We think that we got a great platform or medtech product or whatever that is, and it does it all. It is impossible because we are human beings. We have other needs. But that's a different story. Anca, thank you so much. It's been a fascinating interview. It's really nice to see you. I hope you keep as cool as possible with the weather conditions. And I hope to see you soon. Thank you so much for accepting my invite and delivering these amazing, amazing insights for the audience.
Thank you very much, João, for the invitation. I wish you all the best, and I'm looking forward to following your further updates and posts and your influencer vibe on all social media.
Thank you, Anca. Thank you so much. I'm going to wrap up now. To all our viewers and listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Also, check our channel partners. And I'm going to post the links to connect with Anca on social media, on LinkedIn. Follow her great work. And I'll see you all next week.